A global energy watchdog warns of a significant oil supply shortfall from Saudi Arabia and Russia's output cuts. The International Energy Agency says the voluntary cuts until the end of the year raises the risk of further market volatility. The warning comes a day after oil prices jumped following OPEC's own update, which showed the gap between global supply and demand would be the widest since 2007. The IEA says the world oil demand remains on track to grow to 101 million barrels per day this year, in part due to insurgent Chinese consumption and jet fuel. Looking at global oil futures this Thursday, they are hovering at 10-month highs. Brent crude is poised to trade at $92 per barrel, while West Texas could trade at $89. The White House accuses China of retaliation in ordering a ban on the use of iPhones for state employees. The U.S. National Security said Washington is concerned with the move and called on Beijing to be more transparent. On Wednesday, China's foreign ministry disputed reports about iPhone restrictions while also raising security concerns with the device. Bloomberg News reported this month that China plans to expand the ban to state-backed companies and agencies. The supposed restriction comes amid increasing tensions between the world's two largest economies. Asian markets returned to positive trading even as inflation in the United States came in higher in August. Consumer prices stateside climbed to 3.7% in the said month from the 3.2% in July. The subdued increase managed to allay investor fears over the possibility of another interest rate hike from the Federal Reserve when it meets next week. Looking at the major stock indices now, the Nikkei 225 leading today's gains by 1.4%. The ASX 200 joins the rally after Australia's unemployment rate held steady in August and labor participation climbed. Also in focus, the Chinese markets, both in the red on renewed concerns over its properties sector. In share price movements, shares of Japan's SoftBank are down after its subsidiary Arm priced its initial public offering at $51 per share. Arm's fully diluted market cap is at $54 billion and it will start trading on NASDAQ this Thursday. The Chinese property developer Country Garden also in the negative ahead of a deadline for a bond repayment. Let's take a look at the futures in Europe now. They are pointing to a higher open ahead of the European Central Bank's decision. Sentiment is divided over whether the bank will raise rates for a 10th consecutive time or keep them steady. Over on Wall Street, futures are also pointing up for the major U.S. indices, although investors are bracing for several key economic data, including the producer price index and initial jobs claims.
Now for some local corporate stories. Aboitiz Power Corporation confirms it is aiming to team up with a Thai infrastructure company to boost its digital transformation and operational efficiency. Aboitiz Power did not disclose the name of the company, but says the partnership may happen as early as next month. For telco giant Globe, it has partnered with global insurtech Boltech to launch a new program called Gadget Exchange. This will allow its postpaid client to easily switch mobile devices without having to wait for the renewal of their contract. And finally, Megawatt approves the adoption of an employee stock ownership plan. This is a type of performance incentive under the company's performance management system, where shares of the company may be awarded as part of the identified employee's performance bonus. Only those who have been with the company for at least 1 year are qualified for the scheme. Restaurant operator Foodie Global Concepts says its Mesa brand would soon open shop in the U.S. Foodie COO Eric D. reveals they are targeting to open stateside by next year through a joint venture. The company previously told ABS-CBN News it was looking for a partner for a Mesa outlet in California. D also said here in the Philippines, they saw an increase in revenues despite the rising food costs in the country.
So we're seeing people still going out. And I think people, the Filipinos being resilient, they're still spending for some reason. Definitely pricing adjustments. We've already done, I think, three times. And that's the most price increases we've done in the history. we try to absorb it. Again, Foodie's idea is always to be affordable luxury, wherein we try to make sure that the value proposition is still there.
D also says Foodie's frozen yogurt brand Yao Yao is its superstar. He reveals the current 39 stores will grow to 50 by the year end.
In today's numbers that matter, 11.6 billion pesos, that's the amount of performance-based bonuses for 2021 for over 900,000 public school teachers under the Education Department. In a statement, the Budget Department says it has already released the bonuses, meaning the personnel will soon get them after a two-year delay. The DBM earlier withheld the release of the fund due to inconsistencies in documents submitted by the Education Department.
Philippine avocados will soon be making their way to South Korea. The Agriculture Department says the Philippines will begin exporting mass avocados to its Asian neighbor by the end of this month. The initial shipments will come from orchards accredited by the Bureau of Plant and Industry. The Philippine government initially requested export access for mass avocados in 2009, but was blocked due to pest concerns. Those concerns have since been resolved, and the DA says Philippine avocados have become popular in Korea as the main nutritional ingredient for salads and healthy sandwiches. Now, talking about higher prices of goods, always comes with it market anticipation of a possible rate hike from the Philippine Central Bank. But will the BSP resume its policy tightening this month? Let's find out from Andrea Taguines, who joins us on the line. Andy, what do you think?
Good afternoon, Denise. Banco Central ng Pilipinas Governor Eli Remolona said he does not believe the recent uptick in inflation would warrant an interest rate hike. Inflation in the Philippines accelerated to 5.3% in August following increases in food and fuel prices. But in a press briefing on Thursday, Remolona noted that these price increases were due to supply shocks, which he said usually dissipate fairly quickly. So he said that if there will no longer be any more supply shocks, then it won't be necessary to hike the policy rate. But he also ruled out any chance of easing as well. The BSP has kept its policy rate unchanged at 6.25% for the past three meetings, and it is expected to stay that course when the Monetary Board reconvenes on September 21. BSP Deputy Governor Francisco Daquila Jr. earlier said Remolona wants inflation to be within the government's target range of 2-4% before changing the central bank's policy rate. Remolona believes that the target could be reached as early as October, but he said simply hitting the target would not be enough. He said that he wants to see inflation well within the target range for the year or so. Meanwhile, the BSP also continues to push for the removal of fees for small bank transactions. Remolona said three major banks have already waived fees for transactions below 1,000 pesos. So now he said they're trying to shame more banks into following this policy. As he said, the poor should not be made to subsidize for the rich. The BSP hopes to come out with a payments framework regarding this issue with the help of the Bankers Association of the Philippines as part of its financial inclusion agenda. While the discussions right now just revolve around digital bank transactions, he said the framework they will be releasing will also cover fintechs like transactions done over GCash and Maya. Denise?
Thanks, Andy.